I want to set the stage for Church Without Walls. Church Without Walls, we'll be going beyond the walls every second Sunday, whether it's here, whether it's in an apartment complex. We are going to be behind, outside the walls, because we believe that Jesus needs to be presented and brought to a hurting world. We just believe that with all of our hearts, that, you know, sometimes we can sit back, and I'm not being critical or anything, but we can sit back behind our walls and of our church. We can feel so good about how we're saved and God has blessed us, but there are broken and hurting people that may not even know it. And when we're on the verge of launching our second campus in Richardson, we want to make sure that this community is totally being met, their needs being met adequately. And so we want to thank Pastor Tim, you know, campus pastor here. He's doing a great job here. We love Pastor Tim, but you know, and people have a lot of questions about how we're going to do it. Are we closing this church down? We're not closing this church down, obviously not. We're just moving and planting another church. That's it. We're planting another church. This one will always be here with Pastor Tim and his beautiful wife, Lisa. And so today, I want to talk briefly, very brief, about 25, 30 minutes, about every life matters. Every life matters. Every person on earth matters. I remember there was a season when God had, you know, God met my need of setting me free from being an addict, being an alcoholic, from being a gang member. And for some weird reason, sometimes, you know, people get stuck and think that only people that have these boisterous sins are the ones that's in need. The people that are addicts or people that are doing all this major sin. You know, they got this thing called sloppy sin, and then they got something called sophisticated sin. Let me explain. The sloppy sin is stuff that you can see out. Everyone can see it. Everyone knows you're in sin. It's obvious you're boisterous with it. You're screaming, you're shouting, you're fighting, you're arguing, you're swinging, you're sleeping, you're doing whatever. It's clear. But then you got this sophisticated sin that it's on the inside. You know, it's this bitterness or this anger or this unforgiveness that you harbor in your heart, but you look good on the outside. And so that's what we call sophisticated sin. But also there's some sloppy sin. But I want to put out there today, I want you to know that every life matters. It doesn't matter what type of sin you commit. Your life matters. Every life matters. And when we begin to truly believe every life matters, every person we come in contact with will be compelled to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. Because we know they need to hear the gospel as well. They need to be saved as well. They need hope as well. Every life matters. And it reminds me of the story when Jesus done this miraculous work. Jesus done something that was spectacular, but the people were all upset because he done it on the wrong day. And so it's talking about this guy that had a withered hand. Bible said he had a withered hand. It's in Matthew chapter 12. He had a withered hand, and he needed to be healed. And in Matthew chapter 12, verse 10, I'm going to pick it up. It says, and a man was there whose hand was withered. He had a withered hand. Okay? And they questioned Jesus, asking, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? So that they might bring charges against him. You always know there's some haters out there that's asking questions. They really don't want an answer. No, seriously, they don't want an answer. They kind of like want to trip you up. And it's okay. It's okay. And look how Jesus handled it, though. Jesus is so cool. I love the way Jesus handled things, right? And so he says, but he said to them, what man is there among you who has a sheep? And if it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will he not take hold of it and lift it out? So he doesn't answer the question. What he does is he asks another question. Jesus is so smooth. So they ask him a question, says, okay, what do we need to do with what do we need to do about this guy? This guy's hand is messed up. This guy's hand is withered. Should you heal him today? And so Jesus says, well, let me ask you this. If you had a sheep that fell in a ditch or a pit and it was on the Sabbath, will you not take hold of it and lift it out? How much more valuable then is a person than a sheep? So then it is lawful to go do good on the Sabbath. How do you you matter. You might even hashtag your life matter. You may start talking about, you know, a life that matters. Every life matters. And please don't get this caught up in the political stance of all lives matters or black lives matters. I'm talking about people's souls. So let's get that clear right now, okay? So don't put me in that category. Please don't. I'm saying every life matters, meaning every person you run across, their life matters. That you've got to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them because their life matters. And right here he says, you know what? What person would allow their sheep? And the reason why he's saying these sheep is saying, he's saying, and he started talking about value. The reason why he's saying this is because sheep, that was equating to money back then. If you had sheep, if you had ox, if you had anything, it was equated to money. Like if you had land, you had some type of pasture with all these animals, it was equating to money. So then he talks about value. He says, well, isn't a person more valuable than sheep? He's hitting them in the heart, because you already know money is a heart issue. Soul is a heart issue. Every life matters, but how do you live like every life matters? Let me tell you this. The first thing I want you to get is this, is that we all got to exchange some things. Let's exchange legalism with love. See, what happened here is they got caught up in legalism, the rules, the regulations. They got caught up in, can we do this? Can we do it on this day? Should I lift my hand up this way? Should I wear a dress to church? Should we have jeans on when we preach? Should he have J's on while he's preaching? Should they play that music so loud? And so people begin to start getting caught up in legalism. But we got to exchange legalism with love. See, this is what Jesus did. Jesus said, you know what? I'm going to love. I don't have to worry about the rules and the regulations and what people say. I am going to love this man. This man's hurting. This man has a withered hand. Obviously, he's in need. Why are you even questioning this? If you had a sheep that fell in the ditch, wouldn't you go ahead and pull it out of the ditch? Isn't a person more valuable than a sheep? We got to exchange legalism with love. The rules, that's what I mean by legalism, the rules, the regulations, living by the law. People who are over church. You know what I'm talking about, over church. I'm talking about you just over church. You church every day. Ain't nothing wrong with coming into church, but you just over churched. You know what I'm talking about. Like everything runs through the filter of what rules you got to obey or you got. How do we do it? What do you mean how we do it? We do it how the Word of God says. How do y'all do church? Whatever the Word of God says, that's what we want to do. It's very important for us to exchange legalism with love. It reminds me of this time we were in the city and we were doing a lot of evangelism and we were reaching out to people and we were passing out flyers and we were knocking on doors and we were inviting people to church and we were asking them, hey, come to church, come to church. And so we finally got this person. We was helping support this guy that he needed help with his church, like actually growing. And so we started knocking on doors and passing out flyers and we began to start saying, we want to help you grow your church. Well, as soon as people started coming in, he didn't know how to act. This girl came in with a short dress. And immediately they came over and started talking to her. Said, hey, hold on. You can't come in here like that. Please cover yourself up, your legs. And we were looking outside the team. Their team was like, what is wrong with this dude? We over here knocking on doors. We over lifting up Jesus all in these crazy communities and asking people to come to church. And then all of a sudden, as soon as the person comes, you start telling them to cover themselves up. We got to exchange legalism with love. We have to start loving whoever. Every life matters. And that means everyone. Can you get that? Can we say that? Every life matters. Let me tell you what love says. Love says this. I don't agree with you, but I accept you. I don't have to agree with you. We are in a day and age now where when someone disagrees, they swear them down like it's over with the relationship. You know what? We got to always agree. I don't always agree. Don't get married then. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Do not do it. Literally, do not get married. Because you're going to learn that you don't always agree. But I can't accept. getting this or no? We got to exchange legalism with love. As the story goes on in Matthew chapter 12, it says this in verse 13. It says, then he said to them, Jesus is not finished with them, stretch out your hand. He does a miracle right in front of their face. And he stretched it out, and it was restored whole like the other. Then, here it is, the Pharisees went out and took counsel against him, against Jesus, how they might kill him. This is crazy. They healed this man. And so it's so crazy that somebody can be getting restored and a miracle can take place right there. And as that miracle takes place right in front of them, they're more concerned about what day it was on. So you know what else we need to do? We need to not only exchange legalism with love, we need to exchange religion with restoration. Like, this man's hand was restored, but religion didn't do it. It wasn't the day that they done it on. See, what I mean by religion, let me explain this. It's routine and stagnation. Sometimes, you know, I know in Metanoia, Dallas right here, it's stuff changed so much. People are like, well, y'all still doing this? Nah, stuff changed so much. Can our team say amen? I'm telling you, it always changed. Why? Because, you know, what we want to do is we want to make sure that we don't get in a routine and stagnation of doing the same thing. Because you can start doing something and you don't have the heart behind it. You're just doing it. You're just doing it now and no heart's behind it. And what I call it is a shell of a person. Well, we're doing stuff on the outside, but there's no inside. There's no motivation. There's no passion. There's no relationship behind it. It's just routine. So we got to have a restoration mindset. Where does restoration start? Restoration starts with God and man. The relationship with God and man. So important for you and I to restore what vibrant relationship we might once had. Some of us may have been on fire for the Lord at one time. And something happened. Something got in between it. It's so important for us to exchange religion, the routine, because I don't know how many times in my personal walk with God I've had to revamp it because I was just going through a routine, going through emotion. And yes, I testify that I'm a transparent guy. Even as a pastor, somewhere where you're just doing it, you're just going through the routine. Oh, I wish I had a few people that was transparent out here. Just going through the routine. You go to church because why? Because we go to church. That's what we do. I mean, it's Sunday, right? I go to church. But no passion, nothing behind it, no drive, no nothing. And I don't know how many times I've got on my knees seeking God, and there's no restoration there. It's just routine. It's religion. Because I woke up, and hey, this is what I do in the morning. I get on my knees, and something's happening. And so Jesus destroying all of that. Jesus says, you know what? Stretch your hand out. I want you to be restored. Don't worry about this religion that's all around you. Don't worry about all these people that's hating on you. All these people that got caught up in the routine of their day of going to church. Because this is what was going on with the Pharisees. So much that a miracle was taking place right before them. And they weren't excited about it. You know you're going through a religious routine in a rut when you're not excited about miracles around you. When someone's telling you a story about their life being transformed or their marriage being healed or something happening inside their heart, and you're like, okay, what do we need to do? Because the person that's caught up in religion is caught up in works and not worship. You see, they're caught up in what we got to do instead of what Jesus done. Are you getting this or no? And so it's so important for us to get this. We don't ever want to get to a place where we're not excited about God doing something in someone's life, or God doing something in our heart, or God doing something in someone's life through us or through another church. It don't matter where it's at. It's a big C mentality, a big church, not small C. It's not about Metanoia DFW. It's about the kingdom of God. Are you getting this or no? Restoration is the goal, man. Not religion. And you won't get restoration in your marriage when you just go through routine. It'll get stuck. You know when you're stuck. Let me explain when you're, a person is stuck. You're stuck when you're seeing the same thing over and over and over again. Okay, if my car breaks down and I'm on the side of the road, I can't go anywhere. I'm not moving. I'm not destination. I'm not traveling. And if I'm stuck, my car's broke down, as I look out, I don't know I'm stuck, because when I look out, I see the same old scenery. My car's not moving. I'm not going anywhere. I'll see the same thing because I'm not going anywhere. That's how you know you're stuck, when you see the same scenery. You see the same thing. It's happening again in my marriage. It's happening again. Oh my God, here we go again. Arguing over that, all over again. This is when I know that I'm stuck. Are you getting this or no? This is when I know when I'm stuck, when my life is not, you know, thriving. It's not moving forward. So important. That's the ultimate restoration God wants to give us, is the relationship between Him and us, God and man. So if we really want to make sure that we show that every life counts, one, we need to exchange legalism with love. We want to exchange religion with, we want to exchange religion with restoration. And here's the most important thing I want you to get. We want to exchange hurt with hope. It's hard to be hopeful when you're hurt. Matthew chapter 12, verse 20 through 21, as I close this up, he says, he will not break a big twig. Jesus explaining the character of God. He says, he will not break a big twig. Let me explain that. If the twig is bent and it's about to break off, he won't finish him off. It's talking about the character of God. Look what else it says. It says, he will not put out a dimly burning flame. Some translations say he won't put out a candle wick that's smothering. Like, he won't finish it off. Like, oh, there's nothing. There's no hope for this. Oh, you might as well just break it off. That's not God's character. He says he will make right win over wrong. The nations will put their hope in him. He's talking about God. He says, I don't care what situation you're in. If you're hurt, he says you have a bent twig. You're hurting. That's the proof that you're hurt. There's a bent twig. He says, but God will not finish you off. God, there will always still be hope with God. That's so amazing. Even when you're hurt, he says, we got to exchange that hurt with hope. It's so important to be hopeful. It's so important to be hopeful. But sometimes what happens is we get caught up in the environment around us, and we begin to start looking at the environment around us, and that's what hinders us from being hopeful. It reminds me of the story of the flea. A flea has a vertical of 36 inches. And so a flea can jump about 3 feet. But if you get a flea and you put him in a mayonnaise jar and get a lid and tighten the lid and put the flea in there, it'll jump up. And he'll try to get out, because remember, a flea has a vertical of 36 inches. Well, he'll hit his head a few times, a flea, and then he realizes, I'm not getting out of here. And he'll make the adjustment according to the environment. So what'll happen is he'll stop jumping all the way and hitting his head on the lid, because the environment have trained him, he's not going to go any further. And if the flea has babies while they're in that mayonnaise jar, the babies will never jump up and hit their head on the lid of the mayonnaise jar, because they're already trained by their parents that they can't go any further based on their environment. It's so important to know that there's so much potential in each and every person, but you cannot limit yourself based on your environment. You cannot look at your environment and allow your environment to hinder you. But so where do we put our faith? Where do we put our faith? We put our faith in Jesus Christ. This is what Jesus is doing here. Jesus is saying, hey, if you want to make sure every life counts, what you need to do is you need to exchange that legalistic mindset of dropping rules on people before you love on them. Let me explain something else. Moses brought the children of Israel out of Egypt. And when he brought them out of Egypt, they were out for a long time. And all the way until chapter 20, they've been out. They've been provided for. God had provided food. God had provided clothes for them. They, you know, because their clothes never wore out. Do you know that they never dropped the law until So if we want to show that every life matters, this is for everyone, we don't tell people the rules first. We don't give them the law first. We don't give them legalism. We give them love. We don't give them religion. We try to help them get restored. And you know, more importantly, we don't hurt them. We give them hope. We don't hurt them. We give them hope. Anybody, and watch this, and you say, well, I've been hurt before. Well, I want to tell you right now, if you've been hurt from a church, I want to say it on behalf of every church, and please accept it. Please forgive us. If you've ever been church hurt, that's a real situation. People get hurt in churches. But there is hope. Because there's always forgiveness. Long as there's forgiveness, there's always hope. Long as there's forgiveness, there's always hope. In relationships, the biggest thing that a person needs in a relationship is hope. And so as we close this up, I told you I wouldn't go too long, but I wanted to make sure that you understood what this Church Without Walls is all about. It's all about going beyond the walls, taking the church to the community. And we'll be getting with you guys, because we may not be here next time, next month. We may be somewhere in some projects. I just knew everybody was going to be excited about it. Is it on? Is it working? Can you hear me? Y'all gonna come with us, right? You gonna come with us? I know we gonna go in the hood. We gonna go bring hope to the hood. Any of y'all excited about that? I'm excited about Jesus being brought to a broken area. Come on, let's lift up my hands, lift up my heart. If you've been a person today that you begin to start thinking about legalism instead of love when you come to the doors of the church, I want to make sure you know that we don't care if you get paid from using drills or with $1 bills. You're welcome here. We don't care if you're black, brown, green, yellow. If you're a lawyer, if you're a doctor, if you have a background of having kids before wedlock, we don't care if you're not married, you're married. We don't care about none of that. We just want to love on you. We just want to love on you. Every person here, I want you to walk through the doors and experience the love of God and not legalism. I don't know how many times people have been hurt through legalism. They walk through the doors and they get hit with religion. They came here for restoration. People come to church for restoration. They don't come for the root or the religion. They come for restoration. They don't come to get hurt. They come for hope. And I want to tell you, there's always hope. Because as long as you have a pulse, you have a purpose. As long as you are still breathing, there's still an opportunity for you to get it right. If you woke up today, I don't care what happened in the past. I'm telling you, we could be here all day talking about my past. But Jesus have turned all that around, and Jesus, he can turn anyone's life around if you just truly lift up your heart and say, you know what, God? I'm trusting you. And if you're that person today that maybe you've been hit by legalism, you may have been hit by religion, you may have been hit with a lot of hurts. Today, can our team come up and can we pray for you? If you don't mind us praying, if we can get Pastor Tim and a team of people, and I may be breaking up a little bit so you may not hear everything, but if you feel like you want to get restored, you know what, you may have been through church hurt, or you may have been going through a season, it's okay. The first step
to freedom.
The first step to freedom is truth. Just being truthful, being honest. This is where I'm at. This is what's going on in my life. And so if you're that person that may have never accepted Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, what I want you to do is I want you to raise your hand. I want you to come up here. We want to pray with you. We want to lead you. And if anyone can hear the sound of my voice, I don't care if you're in that parking lot, if you're here right in before me, or if you're online, I want you to repeat this simple prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, I recognize my need for you. And today, I open the door of my heart and I invite you in.